السنة مثل سفينة نوح، من ركبها نجا ومن تركها غرق.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. That الغيب المطلق means absolute and complete knowledge of the unseen that is known to Allah alone only. الغيب المطلق can be divided into two categories. Or the people of knowledge have divided al-ghayb al-mutlaq into two categories. Last week we took the categories of al-ghayb, which was al-ghayb al-mutlaq and al-ghayb al-nisbi or al-idhaf. Today, in the fifth issue, al-mas'alatu al-khamisatu, we are taking that al-ghayb al-mutlaq is divided into two categories. The first category, al-qism al-awwalu, this category is such that there is explicit evidence that has been narrated concerning it, that Allah has concealed the knowledge of this issue from mankind, jinn, angels, and the whole of the creation. So explicit evidence initiates that this type of knowledge is only known to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Nobody has knowledge of such issues except Allah. No one is acquainted or granted knowledge of such affairs, whether it's an angel or a prophet. لا ملك مقرب ولا نبي مرسل. For example, the five keys of the unseen as mentioned in Surah Al-An'am, ayah number 54. The exact time when the day of judgment will occur. Surah Al-Luqman, ayah number 34. These type of issues, their knowledge is only known to Allah and it's specific to Him. Many people asked the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that when will the day of judgment happen? And he would answer that its knowledge is with Allah alone. You may refer to the hadith, the famous hadith of Imam Muslim in his Sahih known as the hadith of Jibreel. When Jibreel alayhi salam asked him this question. So this category of al-ghayb al-mutlaq, this category cannot be known to anybody except Allah. Meaning that this is an attribute or sifa of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when Shaykh al-Islam, Abu al-Wafa sana'ula Amr al-Sari rahmatullah alayhi, inserted a chapter heading known as Ilmul Ghayb. This is the category that he intended. That he generally mentioned Al Ghaybul Mutlaq, and from Al Ghaybul Mutlaq, he was referring to the first category of Al Ghaybul Mutlaq. So, therefore, this category of Al Ghaybul Mutlaq, which is specific for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is a sifa or an attribute of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, a quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, cannot be attained by being gifted. وهبي أو كسبي. Cannot be attained by being gifted. Wahabi. Or kasabi, striving. Like the Sufis claim. That if you reach a certain stage, you can know the knowledge of the unseen. Or atai. Granted. As these are words which the people of innovation claim. Surah Al-An'am. Ayah number 54 and Surah Al-Luqman, ayah number 34. So when the ulama talk about al-ilm al-ghayb, or when ilm al-ghayb is mentioned generally, this is the category that they refer to. Al-ghayb al-mutlaq, and from al-ghayb al-mutlaq, that which is specific or an attribute or quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And no one from amongst his creation, no matter how great or close to him, has knowledge with regards to such affairs. And for this we have explicit proof and evidence that can be found in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wadih, clear? The second category of al-ghayb al-mutlaq is that category where we don't find any explicit evidence which indicates that this knowledge of the unseen, which in its essence or fundamentally is unknown to mankind and jinn and to the creation, will be kept concealed from them. So there's no evidence in the Quran or in the Sunnah to say that this knowledge is only for Allah. Fundamentally for us, we do not have knowledge of such affairs. So this category, Allah the Most High may acquaint and inform some of His creation to whom He wishes, like from amongst the angels and the messengers. Wadih? So for example, Allah says in Surah Jin, ayah number 26 and 27, where He says, عَالِمُ الْغَيْبِ فَلَا يُظْهِرُ عَلَى غَيْبِهِ أَحَدًا. That He is the knower of the unseen, and He does not disclose His knowledge of the unseen to anyone. إِلَّا مَنِ ارْتَضَى مِنْ رَسُولٍ فَإِنَّهُ يَسْلُكُ مِنْ بَيْنِ يَدَيْهِ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِ رَصَدًا إِلَّا مَنِ ارْتَضَى. Except whom He has approved of messengers. And indeed, He sends before each messenger and behind him observers. So Surah Jin, ayah number 26 and 27, establishes the second category of al-ghayb al-mutlaq, where some form of knowledge which was hidden fundamentally and was only known to Allah, Allah has taught mankind, from amongst His mankind, some of His selected slaves, like the angels and the messengers, has informed them of such issues. So the theme of this ayah, as explained by Al-Imam Al-Qurtubi, when he explains this ayah of Surah Al-Jin, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first absolutely negates anybody having any form of knowledge of the unseen, Al-Ghayb Al-Mutlaq, which is khas for him, and then makes an exception that certain things from amongst that which is unknown to mankind may be revealed to mankind for whomever Allah chooses. So Qurtubi says that the knowledge of the unseen is not disclosed except for the one who He, Allah, is pleased with, selects and accepts. This means He, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, chooses for prophethood. This means that who he chooses for prophethood, this chosen person, a prophet, is acquainted and granted knowledge of the unseen for whatever Allah wishes for him to be known. By the way of revelation. So that this can be a proof and evidence for his prophethood. So having some knowledge of the unseen by a prophet or a messenger is a mu'jaza and a proof and evidence that this person is a messenger or a prophet from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the reasons or sabab or the hikmah behind the prophets and the messengers having knowledge of the unseen, some parts of the knowledge of the unseen, is to strengthen their argument with clear proof that what is being informed to them is being informed to them by the Creator. And it's a mu'jiza, and from the Dala'il al-Nubuwa, a landmark or a sign or evidence that they truly are messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in Surah Ali Imran in ayah number 179. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهُ لِيُطْلِعَكُمْ عَلَى الْغَيْبِ وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ يَجْتَبِي مِنْ رُسُلِهِ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Nor would Allah reveal to you all the unseen, but instead Allah chooses of his messengers whom he wills. Surah Ali Imran ayah number 179. So this is the second category of Al-Ghayb Al-Mutlaq. From amongst Al-Ghayb Al-Mutlaq, Allah teaches mankind what he was ignorant of by teaching him and revealing to him some issues concerning Ilm Al-Ghayb or Alim Ghayb, so that they may be acquainted with this and so that it may be proof an argument for those who Allah has selected, as the word Nabi means to inform something which was unknown to mankind, or to inform mankind which Allah has revealed to that Prophet. I'll be clear on this issue now. Do we understand the difference between Al-Ghayb Al-Nisbi Al-Idhafi and Al-Ghayb Al-Mutlaq and this category?
No, sure.
It's a fine difference. The Brailwis, the deviated sect, the Brailwis, lie to the people and say, we believe the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has no knowledge of the unseen, that we deny. But the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was granted any form of the knowledge of the unseen. And this is batil. So the Shaykh Abu al-Wafa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, rahmatullahi alayhi, intended that al-ghayb al-mutlaq, that is specific for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this type of knowledge is not known to anybody other than Allah. Whereas the second category, as mentioned in Surah al-Jin, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the most knowledgeable amongst the creation from mankind and jinn, of what he was informed of. So when we discuss with the Brailwis, what the Brailwis do is that they mix up Al-Ghayb Al-Mutlaq with Al-Ghayb Al-Nisbi and the second category, and they make a meal out of everything and then they discuss with us. So Ya Talib Al-Ilm, when you discuss the knowledge, when you discuss the issue of Ilm Al-Ghayb, the first thing you ask him is, tell me, define for me what is Ilm Al-Ghayb. And what did they do? What do the Brailwis do with the ayat of the Quran? They use Surah Al-Jinn and they say, look, the Prophet ﷺ knew knowledge of the unseen. And then they make that Al-Ghayb Al-Mutlaq absolutely for the first category. So Allah taught the Prophet ﷺ it. Am I making any sense to what I am saying? and other students understanding how the people of deviation, they mix up the categories. The Ahlul Hadith, when they talk about a certain issue and when they derive the Aqeedah from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they combine all the evidences together so that there is no apparent contradiction between Al-Ghayb al-Mutlaq and Al-Ghayb al-Nisb. There is no contradiction between that which is specifically for Allah and that which Allah has revealed to His slaves. And from amongst them, the Messenger of Allah, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So for those who accuse us and say that we say that Moses did not know what was behind the wall, that these type of derogatory statements were never used by us or by our scholars. But what we do say that the Prophet's knowledge was restricted and not absolute like what they say. So is this issue clear? So the Brailwis, remember what the Brailwis do. When we discuss with the Brailwis ascribe and establish the first category of Al-Ghayb al-Mutlaq, which is specifically for Allah, for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the saints. And this is shirk. And this is the shirk al-akbar. Wadih.
Naam, Shaykh, wadih.
With regards to this, we come to the end of the fifth issue. Now I will give you examples with regards to the Diobandis. The Brailwis, the issue is clear. The Brailwis openly say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had knowledge of the unseen. Absolutely. Al-Ghayb al-Mutlaq. Ma kana wa ma yakun. What happened and what will happen. He knows of everything. Juz'i and kulli. Azali and Abadi. The Prophet has knowledge of everything. He has knowledge of the five keys. He has knowledge of everything. With regards to the Diobandis, then the Diobandis theoretically say exactly as we say. But practically, because of their tasawwuf and their Sufi, Naam, Al-Mas'alatu Al-Sadisatu, which is the sixth issue. And like I mentioned, that the Diobandis theoretically agree with the Ahlul Hadith and Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, but practically, and when it comes to the implementation, they go against what they say that they believe. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا لِمَا تَقُولُونَ مَا لَا تَفْعَلُونَ. Because of their tasawwuf and their ascription to Sufism, they contradict themselves. And this is where the Brailwis totally annihilate the Diobandis for having double standards. So with regards to the Brailwis, then we know that they believe in Al-Ghayb al-Mutlaq, which is khas for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first category. And they affirm that for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abdul Qadir Jailani, and the Awliya, who they claim to be the Awliya. So some examples from the books of the Diobandis that they believe that also that their buzurugs or their elders had knowledge of the unseen. So for example, they say with regards to one of the founders of Darul Ulum Dioband, Sheikh Rashid Ahmad Gangohi, that he would know the whispering of the hearts, the wasawis al-qalb. He had knowledge, he would have knowledge of the wasawis al-qalb of the people. Waswas that would happen in the hearts of the people. Maulana Rashid Ahmad Gangohi had knowledge of such issues. Tazkiratul Rashid, volume 2, page 227. Also, one of the other great sheikhs, which is known, with who they call Sheikh al-Islam, famously, who was a congressman, part of the Congress of India, Hussein Madani, Sheikh Hussein Madani, as he is known as, and Sheikh al-Islam for the Diobandis, they say that he knew the state of the hearts and the state of the graves. That Hussein Madani would know the state of the hearts, whether the hearts were corrupted or whether the hearts were clean. And even the state of the graves. The people in the graves, he would know their condition. He would be able, he knew, he had knowledge of these issues. Refer to Aqa'id wa Kamalat of Ulama Adyumat. Page 69. So Ashraf Ali Thani mentions that I would not sit in the presence of Shah Abdul Rahim Raipuri, because I would fear that he would look through straight into my heart and he would know all my sins and everything. Arwah Salatha, page number 422. So these are some examples. I gave you three examples. There's many, many, many examples that can be given. You start to give the examples from the books. So this is to show that fundamentally our difference with the Deobandis is not whether you should put your hands on the chest or put them below the navel, or whether you do, we should do Rafal Yadayn. These issues come much later. Fundamentally, our differences with them are in the foundations of the deen. And with regards to the issue of ilm al-ghayb. Are the students following what I'm saying? So when they say that the fiqar is harsh and the fiqar is known about me, gives a fatwa that you can't play behind your bandis, and a hoo-how is made, so harsh that he says you can't even pray behind the deal. But we don't see no shirk in them. Openly, like the brains. And trust me, these people have not studied. These are statements of ignorance. And they do not know what we know. And what we have studied. And what we have read. And what we have argued about. And we make it clear. And there's ijma of the ummah on this issue. Anybody that believes that anybody other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows knowledge of the unseen or those issues which are specifically for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, somebody ascribes them to any one amongst the creation of Allah, and this is kufr and shirk, and you cannot place it behind such a person. Now with regards to some of the books that have been written by our scholars on this subject. Allama Taymaki Rampuri Rahmatullah Ali was an imam of the Arabic language. He was a contemporary of Ahmad Razak Hanbali. And him and Ahmad Razak, they had many written debates. Taymaki Rampuri Rahmatullah Ali is a teacher of many of the great Salafi scholars. As Al-Sheikh Al-Gujrati, who was considered a master of the Arabic language and who used to teach in Jamia Milliya in Delhi, was one of the first people to translate Kitab al-Tawheed in the Urdu language. Allama Abdullah Surti Rahmatullah. He was from amongst the students of Allama Tayyib Makki Rampuri Rahmatullah. Allama Tayyib Makki Rampuri Rahmatullah, in refutation of Ahmad Raza Khan Barelvi, he wrote a risala, he wrote a book called Rasail al-Ilm al-Ghayb. Rasail al-Ilm al-Ghayb or Rasail al-Ilm al-Ghayb. I've been searching for this risala now for almost 18 years. Until this day, قَدَّرَ اللَّهُ مَا شَاءَ فَعَلَ, I've not been able to obtain a copy. The last of my research was in correspondence to certain scholars, I was informed that there is a library in Rampur in India, and the book of the Sheikh may be found in that library, which is now under the management of the government. Allama Tayyib Makki Rampuri Rahmatullah Ali was from Makkah. He migrated to India. They say, I've read it. Except Ibrahim has come from trying to refute it. I have the book of Ahmad Raza Khan on this issue. The second book which has been written on this issue is by the Bukhari of his time, Allama Abu al-Qasim al-Banarsi, they used to call him Saif Banarsi, the sword, who refuted the book Kashf al-Sirr al-Maknoon, Ithbat al-Ilmi, Ma Kana wa Yakun. Again, this was a refutation of the Bareilvis. The third book, which was written by another Salafi scholar by the name of Sheikh Badiuz Zaman from Hyderabad, who authored a book called Risala Tahqiq wa Ilm al-Ghayb. It's very important for the Talib al-Ilm to know the books that have been written on this subject. The reason why we mention this is that you know that your scholars, your predecessors, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted them the tawfiq to defend the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and expose the people of Bid'ah. The fourth book which was written on this subject was by Allama Sayyid Abu Turab Rushdullah Shah Rashidi, the grandfather of Sheikh Badiuddin As-Sindi Al-Rashidi. I'm pretty sure that everybody's knows the name Sheikh Badiuddin As-Sindi Al-Rashidi. Sheikh Badiuddin As-Sindi Al-Rashidi is the Sheikh of Sheikh Wasiullah Abbas, Sheikh of Sheikh Rabi, and the Sheikh of many of the Sheikh Dara. He was the Sheikh of Sheikh Muqbil as well. And his grandfather, Sheikh Badiuddin Sindhi al-Rashidi's grandfather, he wrote a book on the issue of Ilm al-Ghayb, calling it Kashf al-Rayb and Mas'alat al-Ilm al-Ghayb. واضح. How many books have I mentioned so far? Another book that has been written is a book by Al-Allamah al-Muhaddith al-Faqih Nadir Ahmad Rahman, who was the teacher and the Sheikh of our Sheikh Wasiullah Abbas. Sheikh Wasiullah Abbas was highly influenced by him, and the Sheikh was the closest to him. And the Sheikh always talks highly of his Sheikh. He wrote a book called Ar-Raddu ala al-Aqa'id al-Bid'iyya, a refutation of the innovative beliefs. واضح.
نعم شيخ واضح.
The next book that was written by the reviver of the Salafi Dawa in Nepal, the great scholar Al-Allama Abdul Rauf Chandagari Rahmani Rahmatullah Alayhi, who was a close companion of Sheikh Bin Baz, who authored a book called Tardeed-e-Hazir-Nazir in the Urdu language, and it's known. And he wrote this book where he established that the Prophet Islam is not omnipresent, nor does the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam have knowledge of the unseen. This book was then refuted by the Grand Mufti of the Bareilvis of India, Abdul Mannan. Mufti Abdul Mannan, who was the Grand Mufti of the Bareilvis, the 50s, 60s, and 70s, wrote a refutation of this book. So Sheikh Al-Allama Abdul Rauf Chandagari Rahmatullah Alayhi, who when he would come to Makkah, for months would stay at the house of Sheikh Wasiullah Abbas, our Sheikh. The Sheikh would host him for months, and then for days they would be in the gatherings of Sheikh Abdulaziz bin Baz Rahmatullah Ali in Mecca. And they would visit the Sheikh, they would discuss with the Sheikh. So he wrote this book, and this book was refuted by the Bareilvis, the Grand Mufti of the Bareilvis, known as Abdul Mannan, and he wrote a book called Ash-Sha'i. After the Bareilvis responded, and always remember this, that when the Bareilvis and the Diobandis try to refute the Ahlul Hadith, do not keep any debts. They always pay back. So our Sheikh, the Grand Mufti of India of his time, of Jamia Salafiyya, the Sheikh al-Hadith of Jamia Salafiyya, Benares, India, Muhammad Rais Nadwi, he responded, I wrote a refutation of the book, Ash-Shahid, written by Abdul Mannan Bareilvi, and our Sheikh, he wrote the book and he called it تصحيح الأقاعد بإبدال الشواهد الشاهد. So this was the response of our Sheikh. When this response reached Abdul Mannan, he attempted to refute some of the issues which our Sheikh had written and clarified. So when this reached our Sheikh, Sheikh Mufti Muhammad Rais Nadwi Rahmatullah Ali, the new edition of Ash-Shahid of Abdul Mannan reached our Sheikh in 1987, and the Sheikh saw that Abdul Mannan had mentioned Sheikh Rais Nadwi by saying, and the Rais, Muhammad Rais Nadwi says, so then our Sheikh once again refuted him once again in 1990. In his new published edition of تصحيح الأقاعد بإبدال الشواهد الشاهد, which deals with 212 issues and is no less than 552 pages. And the Brailwis have yet to respond, and now it has been 28 years and now the Sheikh has passed away. Well, we're still waiting for them to respond back to our Sheikh's book تصحيح الأقاعد بإبدال الشواهد الشاهد. واضح؟ Are the students with me? So this is the book of our Sheikh, تصحيح الأقاعد بإبدال الشواهد الشاهد, as you can see, which was republished. As you can see, the book is, Sheikh finished in 1993, 512 pages. As you can see, just on the issue of the knowledge of the unseen and the process of being already present. This is the book, تصحيح الأقاعد بإبدال الشواهد الشاهد, for the ones who can read Urdu language, هنيئاً لهم, they should read the book of our Sheikh and benefit with the oceans of knowledge that he has. And our Sheikh writes, as Sheikh Wasiullah says, when Mufti Muhammad Rais Nadwi writes on a subject, and after that there is no need for anybody to write after it. So the Brailwis take pride in their book, which was written by Ahmad Razaf Brailwi, on the issue of Ilmul Ghaib. And this book, they say, is called Ad-Dawlatul Makkiyya Bil-Madatil Ghaibiyya, which Ahmad Raza Khan Brailwi wrote in 1332 after Hijrah whilst he was in Mecca. As you can see, I have, these are the editions that I have of this book, Ad-Dawlatul Makkiyya, one very old edition. Alhamdulillah, we have all the books of Ahlul Bidah directly. This is what our shuyukh have told us so that we read. As you can see, this is Ad-Dawlatul Makkiyya of Ahmad Raza Khan Brailwi. This is one edition, notes. This is another old edition that I have. As you can see, Ad-Dawlatul Makkiyya. Madatil Ghaibiyya. If this is the third edition I have, three different editions. Ad-Dawlatul Makkiyya. You see, Ahmad Raza Khan Brailwi. And then they translated this whole book in the English language and they called it the Meccan Treasure on the Subject of the Unseen. This is the English translation, as you can see. As you can see, this is the English translation. So these Brailwis recently in the past 5-6 years have been making big claims on the internet that this book is irrefutable. Nobody can refute this book, Ad-Dawlatul Makkiyya. It was written in 1332. We're now in 1440. So it was written how many years ago? 108?
No.
Years ago. So when I met the great Sheikh in India a few years back, Sheikh Zahiruddin Al-Mubarakuri, my Sheikh, who graduated from Madrasa Rahmaniyya in 1941, I asked him, I said, Sheikh, how Ad-Dawlatul Makkiyya was refuted by some of our scholars? The Sheikh said, what really happened is that when he wrote this book, when I reached the ulama did not see that it was worthy of being refuted. No one paid any attention to it. But now, a big hoo-ha is being made, challenges are being made on the internet. Irfan Mashhadi, the guy who barks and howls like a dog, swears while he speaks in Punjabi, makes the claim and says, nobody can refute this book. We work on this book. And the Sheikh, who is old school, Sheikh Ataullah Derwi, wrote the 300-page refutation on it, on my request, which I am currently editing. We have reached one third of it. And bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, the response to Ad-Dawlat al-Makkiyah, glad tidings to you, O Ahlul Hadith, with the efforts of your teacher, has been refuted. And inshallah, this book will be published by Markaz Sunnah under the banner of Maktaba Ahlul Hadith for publications whenever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decrees for it to be, and we hope to be very soon. Allah Sheikh Ataullah Derwi, we needed a scholar to refute this book who was from the old school. What we mean by old school is that the old school scholars would study everything. They would be masters of all the subjects. Now, when a graduate graduates from Medina, he only knows Sharia. He doesn't know Tafsir. Or he only knows Hadith and he doesn't know. In the olden days, you would have to study everything from A to Z. There was no choices. And somebody who knew mantiq, ilm al-kalam and falsafa, and the istirah of the Sufis very well, Sheikh Ataullah Derwi, may Allah preserve him, who's very old, from his correspondence, me and him, he wrote this book, and it is a masterpiece, I can tell you. A masterpiece. When this is published, it's going to burn the brainies. They're going to be destroyed. They're going to burn in this life and they will burn in the hereafter if they do not repent to Allah. Then we have the Diobandis who also refuted the brainies on this subject. Like I said to you, theoretically, that you agree with the Ahlul Hadith, but they contradict themselves because of their Sufis. That's what duped and Diobandis. Because of their position, but not their practical of what they believe. I gave you three examples that have given you more and more, where they claim that their buzurugs or the elders know what's in the wombs, they know what risk has been given. I said the master scholar of the Diobandis, who was a contemporary of Ahmad Reza Khan Barelvi, and he challenged Ahmad Reza Khan Barelvi for debates, and Ahmad Reza Khan Barelvi ran away. He wrote letters to Ahmad Reza Khan Barelvi. He even said in one of his letters that I've sent him an addressed envelope paid so that he just puts his letter back and accepts my claim. He wrote two volumes and refuted Ahmad Reza Khan on the most of the books that Ahmad Reza Khan Barelvi wrote on Hazir Nazir, Ilm al-Ghayb, al-Istighatha, and the beliefs of over 1,000 pages. Al-Allama Ihsan Ilahi Zahir rahimahullah quoted from him in his Al-Barelwiyyah, mentioned. And this is a very monumental book. As you know, it's 1,000 pages, it's two volumes, as you can see. This is the one, it's called, the Sheikh's name is Maulana Sayyid Murtaza Hassan. His name was Maulana Sayyid Murtaza Hassan. And as you can see, this is the first volume. And it took me 13 years to find the second volume, which is this volume. Said, no, it wasn't available anywhere in Pakistan. And if I tell you how I found this volume, you'd all be laughing and shocked. But most of the scholars that I know have either volume one or volume two. Nobody has two volumes. I'm the only person that I know of from amongst all the scholars that I am in contact with who has both volumes, alhamdulillah. I've read both volumes. It took me 13 years to get hold of this. So, Mawlana Sayyid Murtaza Hassan refuted him, Ahmad Raza Khan Barelvi, and Ahmad Raza Khan Barelvi did not respond back to any of his claims. Then we have the other Diobandi scholar who also refuted the Barelvis. His name is Mawlana Muhammad Manzoor Nu'mani. These are the Rasail of Mawlana Muhammad Manzoor Nu'mani, who tried to come to the Saudis, Salafis here, Saudi Arabia, and tried to tell them that all the Diobandis who spoke against the Salafi da'wah, they were all mistaken, they were misinformed. And he wrote a book in defense of Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, saying Muhammad Abdul Wahhab was a great scholar, and that the Diobandi scholars should be excused of the misinformation they were informed with, etc. But he spent most of his life, until the end of his life, debating with the Barelvis and refuting the Barelvis. He used to have a magazine called Al-Furqan. And then all his rasail, all his books against the Barelvis were all published in one volume known as Futuhati Nu'maniya. And in 1355, he had the historical debate between him and Mawlana Chashmat Ali Al-Barelwi in India in Sargodha, which became known as Munadharat Ilm al-Ghayb. And the minutes of that debate was published in this book, as you can see, and these are the Futuhat. So he was another scholar from amongst the Diobandis. Like I said, theoretically, the Diobandis believe in the Ahlul Hadith, believe, but practically, when it comes to their elders and their Buzrugs, and they fall into kufr and shirk because of the tasawwuf that they believe. Then we have the other Diobandi scholar from Pakistan, the Sheikh al-Hadith, who spent a lot of his life debating with our Salafi scholars, especially our Sheikh, who's still alive, Sheikh al-Shad al-Haq al-Athari, the Muhaddith of Pakistan. They wrote many refutations against, but when it came to the issue of Ilm al-Ghayb, then he refuted two of the books of the Barelvis. One was the refutation of Tawzih al-Bayan in four parts, and he called it Itmam al-Burhan. I mean, there all the philosophical arguments and everything are all written, almost 300 pages. He also wrote a refutation against another Barelvi scholar who wrote a book called Ithbatu Ilm al-Ghayb, and he called it Izharul Aib fi Kitabi Ithbati Ilm al-Ghayb. Sufra Saftar Diobandi. Again, this one he wrote in 230 pages. Again, theoretically, they're with us. When it comes to practically, they make all these stupid excuses with regards to what has been written. Kashf and all that, which we are going to come to the next issue. Now, so these are with regards to some of the books that have been written. There's one book that has been written by the Sheikh of our Sheikhs, Allama Abdul Jalil Al-Samurodi Al-Gujarati, which is a manuscript which I have. I have worked on, and it's called الرد البليغ بأحاديث الصحيحين على من أثبت علم الغيب لنبي الثقلين. All the hadith that can be found in Bukhari and Muslim which negate the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam knew knowledge of the unseen. All the narrations are here, alhamdulillah. We just need to, as you know, that I was working on this, some parts of it. And inshallah, it's a small risala, but one of the most amazing risalas that I've come across. We're writing an introduction to it, it's in Arabic language, which we will publish with Allah, refuting the Barelvis from only the narrations of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that can be found in Bukhari and Muslim, where ilmul ghayb, knowledge of the unseen, was clearly negated by the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As you know, that alhamdulillah, our Shaykh Masih Allah Abbas takes great pride in my library. الحمد لله. He will always phone me with regards to a book that he's searching for or that he's in need of. And alhamdulillah, most of the time I would say to the Shaykh that alhamdulillah, that book is available in my life, my Shaykh. Another risala which Mawlana Muhammad Safraz Diobandi wrote. So he wrote three books, the two books which I showed you, and then he has another book which is called Mulla Ali Qari Hanafi wa Mas'ala مسألة علم الغيب والحاضر ناظر. So three books he wrote between the debate between the Deobandis and the Brelwis, just like the Jews and the Christians always argue. We find the Deobandis and the Brelwis are always arguing amongst themselves, and we Ahl al-Hadith just sit down and relax and watch the show. The seventh issue, and in the seventh issue we will cover Kashf, إلهام، محدث، and the narration يا سارية الجبل of Umar ibn Khattab رضي الله عنه. As you know that the Sufis, when they want to say that their scholars and their buzrugs and their elders have knowledge of the unseen, they don't say that they have ilm al-ghayb. Except for the Brelwis. Brelwis are upfront. But the Deobandis and the other types of Sufis will say that our scholars, they have kashf. So they use this terminology called kashf. Has anybody heard of this terminology amongst the Sufis called kashf? They usually translate the word al-kashf in the English language as intuition. Intuition. But this is incorrect because it's not intuition. So we need to know that is there a difference between kashf and ilm al-ghayb? The first thing which we will say is yes. Ilm al-ghayb is a term that can be found in the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The word kashf is an innovative term which was invented and introduced and innovated by the Sufis. واضح.
نعم شيخ واضح.
So we need to know the definition or the ta'rif of kashf. So I'm going to give you a definition, a ta'rif of kashf, which is agreed upon by the Brelwis and the Deobandis. Because a scholar who was from the 8th, 9th century, who died in the year 816 after Hijrah, Ali ibn Muhammad ibn Ali al-Zain al-Sharif al-Jurjani, wrote a book called Al-Ta'rifat, Kitab al-Ta'rifat, a book of definitions. That's all he wrote. Al-Hanafi, he defined Al-Kashf for us. What did he say in his book? He said that al-kashf is وَهُوَ الْإِتِّلَاءُ عَلَى مَا وَرَاءِ الْحِجَابِ مِنَ الْمَعَانِي الْغَيْبِيَّةِ وَالْأُمُورِ الْخَفِيَّةِ وُجُودًا أَوْ شُهُودًا. This is what he said when he defined al-kashf. He said al-kashf is to acquaint knowledge which is concealed and hidden from the occult and unknown issues, meaning that those issues are impossible that they may will be known. For example, the issues of the heart, etc., things which are intangible. And hidden affairs, affairs which can only be known. For example, what's happening in your house, what you did with your wife, what you did with your son, what you did with your mother, that either would have been known by them being present or witness. So they were not there, but they know what's going on. So they're sitting somewhere else and something is happening and they know of this. The scholar of the book Tabaqat al-Sufiyya, who died in the year 412 after Hijrah, أبو عبد الرحمن محمد السلمي when he defines الكشف روزباري when he talked about the كشف of the Sufis he said هو المشاهدات للقلوب والمكاشفات للأسرار والمعاينات للبصائر والمراعاة للأبصار الكشف is the witnessing of the hearts unveiling of the hidden issues and those issues that would only be known with firm insight knowledge visually and the insight of those issues perceptibly this is what he defined as al-kashf are we clear?
No, I'm sure.
So far from the definitions. So we understand that Al-Kashf means to acquire knowledge of the unseen or of those issues which would be hidden, which could only be known to us by either being present or witnessing those issues. This is Al-Kashf. Are we clear with the definition of Al-Kashf? The difference between that and the knowledge which is granted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the knowledge of the unseen is that the Sufis claim that they can do kashf at any time. And the knowledge of the unseen is granted to the messengers and the angels through revelation by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's it. The great Diobandi scholar who's living at the moment Mufti Abdul Rashid Ad-Diobandi has written a book called Kashf Ki Hakikat and in his book on page 10 he said that the only people who get Kashf are the Aghbiya, the mental people. He says Kashf is for mental people. People who've lost their bearings. This is what he says. One second. And this is what he says here on page 10. He says, اس پر اہل فن کا اجماع ہے کہ کشف زیادہ تر اغبیاء کو ہوتا ہے. He goes, the experts, there's ijma amongst the experts that kashf only happens to the aghbiya, the ghabi. Aghbiya is the jam of ghabi, which are fools and people who are daft and mental. Here's by Mufti Abdul Rashid Ad-Diobandi. Here's written this. And he mentions on page 10 that kashf is not a hujja. Nobody can bring kashf and bring it as an argument. So it is clear that kashf, next time you speak to kashf, tell the people that the Diobandi Sheikh says that kashf is for the fools, for the mental ones. Yes. If he's getting kashf, then he must be mental, according to Abdul Rashid Diobandi, who is regarded as an authority in Pakistan, in Karachi, where he's located. Wadih?
Naam, Sheikh, wadih. Jazakallah.
So now we understand what Kashf means to obtain and acquaint knowledge of the unseen or those affairs which would be hidden and could only be present or witness them. And somebody might argue, then what about these cameras and all this? Is this not kashf? Then I'll say to you, go back to what we studied about al-ghayb al-nisbi wal-idhafi. And that should answer your question. Walillah alhamd wal minna. We did not talk about the issue except we clarified everything.
Alhamdulillah.
And if you understood al-ghayb al-nisbi or al-idhafi, then for you to say to me, well, I could be here in Saudi and I could have cameras in my business in England and be sitting in Saudi and knowing what's going on. Is this not knowing ilm al-ghayb? Do you stop acting foolish and stupid? Go and study the deen. Study the terminologies of what is called ilm al-ghayb and al-kashf. So this is with regards to Al-Kashf. We know the difference between Al-Kashf and Ilm al-Ghayb.
نعم شيخ.
واضح.
واضح.
And when they say that they have Kashf, what they mean is Al-Ghayb al-Mutlaq, of Al-Ghayb al-Mutlaq, which is added specifically for Allah, or that which Allah would choose His slaves to know of through revelation, which is now seized, and this is what they claim to be Kashf.
نعم شيخ واضح جزاك الله خير.
Now the next issue is al-ilham. What is al-ilham? So we have ilm al-ghayb, we have kashf, and we have ilham. And the Sufis are very smart that they mix up ilham and al-kashf to deceive the people. Be very careful. So that your buddies will be talking to you and they'll bring you examples. They say, look, so-and-so great scholar which you believe also had kashf. La, la, la. There's a difference between kashf and al-ilham. Although they are used alternatively, and sometimes you may find the scholars that they use the term kashf because it means ilham out of necessity. And you'll find Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim using this, but the one who reads the kalam of Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah and Shaykh al-Islam Ibn al-Qayyim and does not know the context in which the sheikhs are using, is going to go around like these foolish students or some of graduates from Medina who didn't study with the ulama. I'm going to go say, oh, you know what, Shaykh al-Islam even affirms kashf. He says kashf. Look. Ya Ghabi. See what Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah is talking about. So always remember, ta'rifat, definitions are the first thing when you discuss with the people of Bidah. The first thing you tell them, haddith lana, arif lana, al-kashf. He might define al-kashf as ilham. You'll say, if this is what you mean by al-kashf, then this is what we say is ilham, then if this type of kashf, then we agree with this. Because this is ilham, not kashf. Do you understand the fine difference?
نعم
يا معشر الطلاب, that these newly invented terminologies need to be determined before they be discussed. So what is al-ilham? Again, al-Jurjani al-Hanafi, who died in after 800 after Hijrah, he defines al-ilham. He says, وَالْإِلْهَامُ مَا يُلْقَى فِي الرَّوْعِ بِطَرِيقِ الْفَيْضِ وَقِيلَ الْإِلْهَامُ مَا وَقَعَ فِي الْقَلْبِ مِنْ عِلْمِ وَهُوَ يَدْعُو إِلَى الْعَمَلِ مِنْ غَيْرِ إِسْتِدْلَالٍ بِآيَةٍ وَلَا نَظَرَ فِي حُجَّتِهِ وهو ليس بحجة عند العلماء إلا عند الصوفيين. إلهام, الإلهام. He says, الإلهام, it can be translated as intuition. And he says, the first definition that he gives of الإلهام can be considered to be the definition of the Sufis. And could mean al-kashf, which is that which enters the heart by the way of an overwhelming innate Sufi knowledge. Innate of Sufi knowledge. بطريق الفيض. Faith is the inner or innate Sufi knowledge that's taken faith, you know, from heart to heart, they say. For the Sufis, they go sit by the graves of their sheikhs and their masters, and they say that the fayyuz, the faydan, you know, you heard the word faydan, faydan means fayyuz. Innate knowledge. When the Sufis use the word fayyuz, they mean the innate Sufi knowledge which is passed on from heart to heart. You know, like this, they have this direct line connection, electrical current passes on, they say. Say by the grave, and it all comes. Text me, the Sufi knows I know everything. So this is what Al-Jurjani says. Then he says that it is also said, and this is what we agree with, it is said that it may also refer to that which enters the heart based upon knowledge. Listen, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like that, of compiling his Sahih, Al-Jami' al-Mustad al-Sahih al-Mukhtasar. And it inspires you to act upon it without deducing this act or this action from any ayah or referring to any evidence. And he says, and al-ilham is not considered hujja, a proof, according to the scholars, except for the Sufis. The Sufi says that it's a hujja. Next time you talk with a Sufi at the Ubandi Brail, we say, what is your hujjah? He's going to say, Quran, Sunnah, Ijma, Qiyas. And say to him, Ilham as well. Ilham upon the definition of Al-Kashf, which is the first definition which Al-Jurjani gave, which is, Ma yulqa fi ar-raw'i bi tariq al-faydhi. So something which occurs in your heart, inserts in your heart from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Doesn't go. Shaykh al-Islam Abu al-Wafa Sana'ullah Amritsari rahmatullah alayhi, when he was debating with a Hindu, and the Hindu talked and tried to debate with him on the concept of ilham, he wrote a book on ilham, clarifying the Salafi position. Alhamdulillah, this is the Risala of the Shaykh, as you can see, very old, almost 100 years old, alhamdulillah, on ilham. And the Shaykh, when he writes, it's just amazing. I read this whole risala in the Prophet Masjid, sitting there, and I benefited so much from this. And he slaughters the Sufis with regards to ilham and the Hindus who try to attack Islam. And maybe if Allah wishes, we may go through this small risala, which will be very beneficial, which will destroy the Sufis, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, for you to increase in your knowledge.
Inshallah.
So he said that ilham, the act said, is something which cannot go against the Quran and the Sunnah. And if the Sufis claim that they have ilham, and it goes into this ilham, it is not accepted. For the innovator is rejected. And so forth. Are we clear?
No, I'm sure.
So ilham is different. Ilham is something which occurs at some knowledge that you have. Bukhari had the knowledge that there was a need to compile a book on only Sahih narrations. Then alhamahullah. Allah put this in his heart, and then he started the work. Which doesn't go against the Quran and the Sunnah, because preserving the Sunnah is already legislated in the Jurjani defines al-ilham like al-kashf. We don't accept that. But his second part, or the second definition he gives, Ahl-Sunnah accept that. Because ma waqa'a fil qalbi min ilmin. Ma waqa'a fil qalbi min ilmin. This type of ilham we accept, which doesn't go, that knowledge, which doesn't go against the principles, the usul, and doesn't go against the Quran and Sunnah. And this is something which is accepted. Allah may open the heart of somebody. And a great example is the mother of Musa. That the wahi that has been mentioned, the wahi is known as the wahi of ilham. Allah put it in her heart that she put Musa in a basket and put him in the ocean.